Welcome to the Atmosphere Church channel. On behalf of all of us here at Atmosphere, thank you for watching. We pray that this message will touch your heart and change your life. Regardless of what you believe, where you come from, or what questions you might have, you are welcome here. Our desire is to help lead you in experiencing God by following Jesus. If you want to find out more information about us, head over to our website at atmosphere.church. And don't forget to click below to subscribe. Enjoy the message.
That's great. It starts with an earthquake, birds and snakes, an airplane. Lenny Bruce is not afraid. I have a hurricane. Listen to yourself. Churn world serves its own needs. Dummy serve your own needs. Feed it up an ox. Speak grunt. No strength. The ladder starts to clatter with fear. Bite down. High wire and a fire representing seven games in the government for hire and a combat site. Left to us are coming in a hurry with the fury's breathing down your neck. Team my team reporters.
Yeah, nothing says good morning than seeing the world burn. So grateful that you guys showed up today. We want to welcome our online fam. We had some tech issues last gathering. So can we give it up for our online fam that stuck it out with us? People are going to church at 3 p.m. their time, so we are so grateful for you guys. My name is Pastor Jim. I'm the lead pastor here, and the reason we played that video is not to scare you, all right? So we had this idea that we started last week, and it goes off of how we ended our study of the book of 1 Corinthians, this ancient letter that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, and he uses this word Maranatha. Go ahead, tell three people around you, say Maranatha. Just say, it's kind of a fun word to say, Maranatha. And what we learned last week is Maranatha means come, O Lord, or the Lord is coming. And a fun fact is that's the only time in the Bible that that word is mentioned, but yet the early followers of Jesus were so mesmerized by the second coming of Christ, and they were so desperate for it that they replaced their normal greeting of shalom with this word Maranatha. They wanted to focus on the upward call of God, that one day he promised he's gonna come back. And they were like, I hope it is soon. How many of you hope the coming back of the Lord is gonna be soon? How many of you? Our singles are like, I wanna get married first. I feel you. That's how I felt before I got married. All right. So that's fair. But we're going to continue our conversation where we left off last week. So we were in Matthew 24. And for those of you that weren't here last week, remember, like, we did this Bible study about a month ago in our daily Bible reading plan. And I remember when I was reading it, I was thinking to myself, man, this needs to be preached. And I felt like the Holy Spirit just moved in me in that moment to say, you need to speak on this. And so you can't really talk about Matthew 24 without talking about Matthew 25. Because Jesus is continuing this thought. So the disciples, for those of you that weren't here last week, the disciples asked the question, when is it all going to end? Have you been watching some of the events going on in our culture and in our world, and you've had the same thought? Like, is this going to be the end? Is this event that's happening? How many of you thought when COVID broke out, like, this is it? But yet here we still are. You know, events happen like that. Well, the disciples, they were convinced, like, man, this is gonna end someday. And Jesus, I loved it. He goes ahead and he tells them, this is what it's gonna be like when the end comes. And the video, which I think is so funny, because a lot of the disaster type movies that we seem to be obsessed with, a lot of the imagery that we see on the screen in Hollywood come from the Bible. So the book of Revelation, and even this passage in Matthew chapter 24. I just love that scene where the Randy's donut thing is fun. You know, so I don't know what your favorite disaster movie is, but one of mine is 2012. I thought that one was a good one. But just get your mind thinking like, wow, how is it all going to end? And scripture doesn't tell us, like, focus in on the time and focus in on the moment. Scripture teaches us just be prepared for that time to come. Be prepared for it. So let me pray. We're going to jump in to the book of 1 Thessalonians. Then we're going to jump over to Matthew chapter 25. But Father, I thank you for preparing us, God. Preparing us for your great return that is going to happen someday. Lord, I pray, God, that as you have met with us in the first two gatherings, Lord, that you would meet with us in this gathering. And God, I pray that you would do something extra special in this gathering. Lord, I feel like somebody came here, they barely got here. Maybe they just had all kinds of adversity working against them to get here, Lord, but they still showed up. I pray, Lord, give them that extra scoop of just wisdom and revelation as we open your word together. I pray, God, for everybody that is watching online, Lord, that you would speak directly to each and every one of them. Give us the ears to hear and hearts to receive everything you want to deposit in us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Okay, so I don't know who I was speaking to, but maybe some next level adversity was coming after you to get here. And I will tell you that in my experience, the more adversity that comes against you from getting the church, the more you need to hear this message. So if you showed up, which you obviously did, all right? Hopefully you're here. If you showing up is half the battle. So you're already halfway to your victory. Come on, somebody. Like, this is how we do church at Atmosphere. So 1 Thessalonians, for those of you that study eschatology, this is not a new scripture. And eschatology is a fancy way of saying the study of the end times. So it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, it says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. And after that, we who are still alive and are left will be," what's that word, church? Two words. "Caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever." The call here is not to scare you, it's to prepare you, because this isn't a horror story necessarily. This is a love story that God wants to be with us. And there is coming a moment in our future where those of us that follow Jesus are going to be with God forever. Now, if you've studied this idea of the end times, you know you probably have heard this word rapture. And some people that, you know, look at the word rapture will tell you, well, it's not in the Bible. Well, it kind of is if you own a Latin Bible. Because the word caught up is harpazo in the Greek language. And in the Latin language, they translate that rapturo, where we get our English word rapture. So the call of God for us is to not look down, but to look up. To be ready for that moment where we get to be caught up to be with him. Now, some people get tripped up on this idea of the rapture. And they get, like, really messed up in their minds. And they're like, you know, when is the rapture going to take place? And people make these predictions. You know, the book of Revelation talks about this 7 years of tribulation where, like, we think the world is bad now. Like, we ain't seen nothing yet. Like, all hell is literally going to break out. And so when is the church, when are we as followers of Jesus going to be caught up? Is it going to be before the tribulation, which in Bible theology is called, you know, the pre-tribulation believers? Is it going to be after the tribulation? Those are called post-tribulation believers or post-trib. And then some people believe that the rapture is going to happen right in the middle. And they're normally referred to as mid-tribbers. But we as a church, as Atmosphere Church, we believe in the pan-tribulation. You may have not heard about this one. But we believe it's all going to pan out in the end. We just get to be with him. All right? We just get to be with him. That's the important thing that we need to focus on. A fun fact is, for those of you that haven't really studied this, you know, the rapture doctrine is a fairly new doctrine within church history. It's only been around for the last couple hundred years. So for the first 1800 years of church history, nobody really talked about this event. So we don't necessarily know what this event is going to be, but Paul seems to believe that there's going to be a moment at the second coming of Christ where those that are alive in Christ get to go up to be with him. Maybe it's going to happen supernaturally, like you know, in the video that it showed people getting raised up. How many saw the old rapture movie where people disappear and their clothes are left all folded up? Remember that movie? I don't know which one. You remember that? And it was like, wow, God's going to rapture us and then fold our clothes for our loved ones that are left behind. So they have a nice, you know, stack of our clothing. I don't know how it's going to go down. But the point is, it's going to go down. It's going to happen. And that's why I really feel the Holy Spirit has been on me as your pastor to teach you guys this. Because I'm going to be held accountable for how I taught you guys. And remember, this isn't to scare you. This is to prepare you. So as we think about this, let's jump over to Matthew chapter 25. Because Jesus is going to continue his talk about why it's important to talk about the end. So he answers the question, what is it going to be like at the end of the age? Like the end times, what's that going to be like? And he answers the disciples, by the way, which I think is awesome. So the question is, and you might even ask that question, is are we living in the last days? And really, it's a silly question because all we have is the days that we're living in right now. So I don't know why we even ask that question. But I believe personally, my opinion is that we are living in the last of the last days. The last days biblically is defined as the space between the time Jesus ascended into heaven and the time that he's going to come back to be with us as King of Kings and Lord of Lords as described in Revelation 19. The time in between is called the last days. So we technically are living in the last days, and I personally believe we are living at the last of the last days. So Jesus goes in and he's a master storyteller. Our Bibles say they call them parables. We would call them stories. So Jesus would always have a story that had a heavenly principle tied up into the story. So there was a moral of the story that had a kingdom of God principle packed in it. And so he gives this analogy and he says, the end will be like these 10 bridesmaids that are waiting for the groom for the wedding. And five of them were foolish and they didn't have enough oil in their lamps. And the other five were wise and they had enough oil. So when the groom came, the five that had their lamps lit, they were ready to meet the groom. But the other five, they didn't have the oil. So they didn't have the light. So they were left out. And for us, it's just like, what does that even mean? Like, that doesn't happen in our day and age. Like, when brides and grooms get married, like, you know, we get to save the date like a year before they get married, and everybody knows and that's going to happen. But that's not how it was in the first century Palestine, you know, couples. They didn't know that. The groom would go away and prepare a house, and the brides were not, like, following their grooms on Life 360 or anything. They didn't know when they were coming back. And they would just show up. And so Jesus was giving them this story because he was saying, you don't know when it's going to be your time to go. So always be ready. And then he moves into another parable and he talks about this investment. And this master has these different investments and he gives one of his servants five of these talents and another servant three talents and another one talent. And then Jesus goes on to talk about how they reinvested these talents that they were given, and your Bible might even say bags of gold. That's another way of saying there was something of value that was entrusted to the servant, and the servant reinvested it, except for the one servant who had the one talent who buried it because he was afraid of his master and what might happen to him if he lost the value that he was given. And so in Jesus' story, the guy that doesn't reinvest his value, he's the one that gets rebuked. And then there's a third story that Jesus throws at us, and he's talking about at the end of the age, there's a separation of sheep and goats. And he goes through this analogy of like, you know, from a distance, you can't tell the difference of sheep and goats. And I grew up raising sheep and putting them in the fair. I had a 4-H club that we were part of. And so I had sheep that I would walk all the time. And they were, my pet sheep. Until I found out that they were being sold to be butchered, then I was crushed as a little kid. It's terrible to do to a little kid. But I was in this like area where from a distance the sheep and the goats they kind of look alike, but then when you get close, you can say, they're totally different animals. So at the end of the age, Jesus is saying, the people that are with God and the people that are without God are going to be very distinguishing, like they're going to be known, and they're going to be put in different categories here. And so Jesus gives us these three ideas, and the distinguishing feature of the last story is that the ones that were the sheep, which were the right ones, he said the reason that they were found to be sheep because of what they did for the least of these. They were hungry and thirsty and naked and sick and in prison, and Jesus said, those people that went and took care of the hungry and fed them and took care of the thirsty and gave them something to drink and naked and clothed them and visited them while they were sick and in prison, he goes, those are the people that really belong to me. So let's talk about that, because I think in these three stories, we get Jesus's point here. The point is not to try to figure out the date when the end is going to come. That's irrelevant. What Jesus is driving at is how do we live while we're living in the in-between? How do we live in the in-between? Like while we're waiting for the coming of Christ, while we're waiting to be reunited with him, how do we live? And so I, just to make this easy, I have three of these points that I want to make. And the first one, just write this down, and that is leave the tank on full. You know what this principle is. All of you probably have a car. You've driven a car. And you know the gas in your tank is incredibly important, isn't it? Or if you drive a Tesla, you know, having that Tesla fully charged before you leave and you're going to go into downtown LA and being caught in traffic, you know that that becomes incredibly important. Why? Because if you run out of gas or you run out of power, that car does you no good. And so when I talk about leaving the tank on full, I'm saying that when it comes to your relationship with God, being full of the Spirit at all times is essential business for your life. Because there is a possibility that you can be saved, but barely saved. Are you following me? You can have the Spirit of God, but barely have the Spirit of God. Like, it's just like, I think he's with me. And that's equivalent, in my mind, to like running your car, or driving your car with the E-light on. That's stressful. I mean, when you, let's be honest, let's be real, okay? On the practical side, let's talk about this for a second, okay? Because I'm going to save you a lot of extra unnecessary stress, all right? So here's the idea. You are hungry. Your car is running out of gas. And so you're like, I just want to go home and eat. I'll fill the tank up later. I know you've done this. Okay, so you go home, you eat, you're full. You're like, let's just watch something on TV. Let's relax. And then you forget about the car until tomorrow morning. And you're running out the door because you're 5 minutes late for your appointment or for work. And you get in the car, you fire it up, and it turns on. And there it's staring at you in the face on the dashboard. You have no gas. And now you're going to be really late. Or else, are you going to play the odds? Are you going to really trust how many miles till empty that is reading on? Okay, let's be honest. How many of you tested the miles till empty and got it down to zero? Come on, there's a lot of you guys. You really did that? You really went down to zero? Did you pray like Jesus with the fishes and the loaves? Like, come on, Lord. It's frustrating to get in that space. And you're just like, oh man, why didn't I just take the extra time and just fill up my tank last night before I got home? It's frustrating, and it's also stressful. I remember clearly there was a time we were leaving Bakersfield, and Tara and I were like driving to Vegas, and there's a little stretch outside of Bakersfield. You climb this mountain, the Tehachapi Mountains. And so we're climbing the mountain. And it dawns on me as we're like getting to the base of the mountain to climb up that I had forgotten to fill up before I left. Eli was on, but I was just like totally in conversation with my wife. And then I just so happened to look at the dashboard. I go, Tara, I forgot to fill up. And I go, there's not another gas station for 20 miles. And it says we only have 5 miles left. I go, what are we going to do? And she just starts laughing. Because I never stress out. And I feel like she always stresses out. All right. I feel like that is the wife's job. You know, the husband's job is just to relax and be cool. Right. But now the table has turned. And so she just is enjoying her husband stressing out. She's like, this is so funny. This is the funniest thing. I've never seen you stress out. I go, we're not going to make it. I go, well, how are you? I'm going to be the guy on the side of the road walking up the mountain with the gas can. And you're going to be stuck in this car and some murderer's going to come and get you. And it's going to be terrible. And she's just laughing. Well, the good news, we made it to the gas station. And I told her, I said, I'm never forgetting to fill up again. Like, see, I want to just use that as a spiritual principle because Jesus is using it to talk about the bridesmaids not being ready because they didn't have enough oil to keep their lamps lit. Like God wants you not just barely saved. He wants you full of the Spirit of God to where you're overflowing. You're splashing out on everybody that gets around you. Like, man, what's wrong with you? You're so loving. You're so at peace. You're so patient because you're full of the Spirit of God. Let me give you a scripture, Ephesians 5:18. Do not be drunk with wine, which will ruin you, but be what, church? But be filled with the Spirit. That's a capital S. That's the Spirit of God. And I love the Greek language here for filled. This is a present participle to give you the basic understanding. It's to be continually filled with the Spirit, which tells me that we have a leak in our life, that we can be full of the Spirit one day, and the next day we can feel like the E light is on with our faith. And I really feel like somebody today, you came on and you feel like the E light is on with your faith. Let me help you out on something. And the reason this becomes such a critical principle that Jesus is teaching is we don't know when tragedy is gonna happen. We don't know when trouble is gonna break out in our life. We don't know. We don't know what's around the bend. I mean, here it was a normal Monday in Westlake. And at 3:30 p.m., a tragedy happened that nobody would ever dream of happening, where some students minding their own business, waiting for a bus to take them home from a crazy Monday at school. And some guy, for whatever reason, decides to plow into them and took the life of a 16-year-old boy. And I don't know, probably most of you heard about this already, but my daughter was right down the street. My son had just been at that school an hour and a half before that at FCA. And a family's life was turned upside down in a moment. And that happens all the time with all kinds of families, including even people in our church. And so as we talk about this, Jesus is saying, be ready at all times, be full of the Spirit. Because when the tragedy takes place, when the trouble breaks out, when you're full of the Spirit, you're going to handle it so much differently than if you're not full of the Spirit. If you're running your spiritual life on E, you're not gonna handle it well. You know, I've said this for years now, but Christianity is shown more in your reaction than it is in your action. How do you respond when trouble breaks out? How do you respond and react when a tragedy takes place in your life? And there will be a total difference in how you respond and how you react when you're full of the Spirit and when you're running your life on E. Total different response. And I just have to speak that over you. Because even though you're having a great moment today and you're filling, let me tell you, the good news is you're filling your tank up right now in this moment. You were filling your tank up when you're worshiping God corporately with your other brothers and sisters in Christ. You're getting your tank full. You're on the charger right now. You're at the charging station, baby. And that's great. But you got to stay on it. You got to keep going back to it. This is why daily devotions become a mandate instead of a suggestion. Why? Because you leak. And even though you're full today, tomorrow is a new day. You know, I came to the conclusion years ago that no matter how high I am on God, when I go to bed, I have to assume that when I wake up the next morning, the E-light's on with my faith. And I have to get with God to fill my tank up every day. And when I started living that way, church, let me tell you, love was next level in my life. Peace was next level in my life. Joy was next level in my life. Why? Because I have love, I have peace, I have joy? No. It's because I'm connecting with the one who is love. I'm connecting with the one who is peace, and I'm connecting with the one who is joy. So if you want more love, joy, peace in your life, you spend time in his presence. And his presence is where you're gonna get filled up. His presence. So daily devotions, essential. Worship through music, essential. Other brothers and sisters, some of you, let me tell you, the one thing that may be keeping you from getting to where God wants you to be is having a couple of like-minded, spirit-filled believers in Jesus in your life. I get really nervous when I'm your only friend, all right? I should say I'm your only friend in Christ. So we do these connect nights on purpose so that you can get some battle buddies. That, you know, when life gets messy, you can lean into somebody and say, hey, bro, I'm texting you right now because this is the 911. I need some prayer. And when you get some battle buddies in your life, they're going to help keep you filled with the Spirit of God. As iron sharpens iron, so does one person sharpen another. So you get battle buddies in your life. You're getting filled in the Word of God and with the worship through music. And all of these are resources to help you stay full of the Spirit. So leave your tank on full because you don't know what's around the bend. That's your L. Leave the tank full. Here's the I, and that's invest in the life to come. Invest in the life to come. I just think it's so interesting. Like, you know, we're pretty good at investing our hard-earned money. Some of you are way better than I am at it. And a good friend of mine, Brad Barrett, he runs a financial company down the street. I didn't know this, but do you know that Townsgate here, at the end of Townsgate, they call it the Wall Street of Westlake? Did you know that? Like, a lot of investments are happening in our area. So we are a culture that kind of knows and understand investments. But I started thinking about this, like, you know, well, a couple thoughts. Number one, I wish I owned a time machine. I would go back to 1980 and buy Apple computer stock. How many are with me on that? All right, okay. Like, I'd be knocking on Steve Jobs' door like, hey, bro, I know what you're doing in the garage, and I'm in. All right, here's $1,000. Let's go. I would have only been 10 years old at the time. But, you know, hey, it would have been a good investment. But think about this. Matthew chapter 6, Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount. Listen to this. And I love how the Passion Translation reads this, church. Listen to this. Verse 19, it says, don't keep hoarding for yourselves earthly treasures that can be stolen by thieves. Material wealth eventually rusts, decays, and loses its value. Instead, stockpile heavenly treasures. I love that. For yourselves that cannot be stolen and will never rust, decay, or lose their value. Stockpile heavenly treasures. See, here's the principle. How you live on earth is how you'll be rewarded in heaven. Did you know that? How you live on earth is how you're going to be rewarded in heaven, which then leads us to this understanding of like, wow, okay. So I have a little bit of time, and I love this illustration. I'm going to borrow it from my buddy Francis Chan because he did this years ago, but it's an oldie but a goodie. Some of you, this will be the first time you've ever seen this. But I have a rope with me. And this rope has a little red line on it. Can you guys all see this okay? All right, you in the back, can you see that red line? It's not very big that far back, but it's on there, all right? Trust me. So this red line represents your entire life here on earth. Let's make it 80 years, all right? If you lived 80 years on this earth, well done. All right. You made it. Okay. Others of you that are past 80, good job. You're in bonus time. All right. So you think about this red line. and this represents your, think about how much stuff in real time is happening for your life, like in this red line. You know, you're born, you know, you learn to walk, you know, you're doing all your toddler things, and then guess what? You get potty trained, you're going to school, you're meeting some friends, then high school breaks out, you graduate, you go to college, all this is happening on this red line, and then, you know, you meet your love of your life, you guys get married, you guys have some kids, and then, you know, now you're in your career, and things are like so much is happening, and it's all in this red line, 80 years. Okay, now what we're gonna do here, Taylor, can you help me? Okay, what I'm gonna have you do is just pass this rope behind you, and you, when you get this thing, just keep pulling it behind you, and the rope behind you, you just grab the rope from them and just keep pulling it, keep pulling it, keep pulling it. Don't pull. Okay, we'll do it. We got a little knot here. We'll just. Taylor, thank you. You're my assistant today. So just keep pulling that now all the way to the back, all the way to the back. Now what I want you guys to do, yay! I love it when we work together. All right. Okay, now what I want you guys to do, lift up that rope. If you have that rope by you, just lift it up. For you guys on both sides, you're just gonna, okay, just, okay. Imagine this. This represents eternity. This rope represents the timeline of heaven, where scripture says a day of the Lord is like 1,000 years, and vice versa. It's like time has no concept in heaven because it's so much. It's eternal. It's forever. Now, think about that red line. Can you show me that red line way in the back there? Now look, okay, compare this whole rope to that little red line on that rope. But yet, we get so caught up in the here and the now that we lose sight of where we're gonna end up at. We're all moving our life towards heaven. Even if you're a non-believer, I have news for you. Even your unbelief is not gonna keep the inevitable from happening. That the Bible declares to us that we will have an end of our lives. Some of you are like, I'm so glad I woke up to come to church to hear this encouraging message. But here's the encouragement. Is when we live our life for the kingdom of God, when we leverage our life for the kingdom of God, God says, I see it, and I'm going to recognize it for all eternity. That there are rewards in heaven. Did you know that? For those people that are faithful to the calling of God and that you are investing in the kingdom of God, that there is rewards for you. That the Bible talks about all these different crowns that we can collect. But let me give you a scripture just to bring you in on this. It says, therefore, do not go on passing judgment before the time, but wait until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the things hidden in the darkness and disclose the motives of human hearts, and then praise will come to each person from God. And that praise can actually be translated thanks from God. That we can live our lives in such a way that when we get in eternity, that God has some thanks that he wants to give to us for investing in his kingdom while we were here on earth. It puts things in perspective when you see this rope, doesn't it? How much time and attention and resources we put into the 80 years that we're going to be on this earth. Listen to how David looked at life. This is King David, Psalm 38 or 39. It says, Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. You have made my life no longer than the width of my hand. My entire lifetime is just a moment to you. At best, each of us is but a breath. We are merely moving shadows, and all our busy rushing ends in nothing. We heap up wealth, not knowing who will spend it. This is David understanding that, like, our life is a vapor. Think about that for a minute, church. There is a morbid website. I don't encourage you to do it, but I did it. It's called deathclock.com. It is a website that helps you predict the time that you're going to check out. So you put in your birthday, you put in your weight and your height, and this is interesting, whether you smoke or not, that's a factor in how they determine your death date. And so I put it in for me. Notice, it says Wednesday, June 15, 2067, but it's down in seconds, and it's just, it's unsettling to see the seconds going. They're just going, and they're like, I want them to stop. But no matter how healthy you eat, no matter how much you exercise, the seconds are ticking off your life. You're welcome, all right? But why am I telling you guys this? Not to scare you. It's to prepare you. Let me give you another scripture. Hebrews 9, 27. Everyone must die once. And here it is. And after that, be judged by God. I want to tell you something that may be very unsettling to some of you. But heaven is not your default position. Heaven is not your default position when you die. The only reason we deserve heaven is Jesus. Say, I'm a good person. That's not fair. Well, you're a good person compared to who? You're a good person maybe compared to your terrible neighbor or your terrible uncle or whatever. God says that one sin disqualifies us from his presence because in his presence, no sin can exist. So here's where the love of God kicks in, that he so loves you that he sent his only son to this earth to give his life up for you, to absorb all of your sin and all of my sin, all of your mistakes and all of my mistakes. And he went on the cross and he absorbed all of that in his perfectness, in his goodness. He absorbed it and he gave his life so that the righteousness of God can be found in us because it is found in him and now he lives in us. And that's the only reason we even deserve heaven. So without Jesus, we don't have a chance. Even on your best day, it's still gonna fall short. That's what scripture declares to us, and you know that's what your conscience declares to you. So without Jesus, we're in trouble. But the good news is, not only did Jesus absorb our sins so that we could get to heaven, as I told you guys on Easter Sunday, it's so that heaven can start reigning and living in us now. That we can start investing our life now by the more heaven that is moving through us, the more that day comes when we're gonna stand before God. He's gonna be able to reward us. The praise of God is gonna be given. The more heaven is being able to be lived through us. This is so amazing to me. I remember like being little, I'm gonna date myself, but I would always love it when the teacher gave me a scratch and sniff sticker on my paper. How many of you 80s kids out there? Remember that? Man, when the grape sticker, good job, Jimmy. Like I scratch it like, I did good. Can you imagine heaven scratch and sniff stickers? Can you imagine? I mean, think about this, church. I know I don't want to like minimize this by thinking about like stickers, but I just want you to think, like, we are living our life so wrongly because we're investing in all the wrong things. The most beautiful investment you can make in your life is not to invest for your retirement on earth, but for your retirement in all eternity. And I'm not downplaying or dismissing, having an investment to retire now. But if some of you, let's be honest, if you put as much emphasis on eternity as you are with your wealth right now, you know you would be such a godly person. And this whole idea about investing wisely is to get our attention on what really matters, and that is heaven, which is going to last for all eternity. That's it. So what do we do with that? Well, I look at our life that God has entrusted with three categories: time, talents, and treasure. Write that down. Time, talent, and treasure. Think about this. You have time. And some of you, you've never looked at time as a commodity, but time is a valuable commodity. Like, you could be leveraging more of your time for the kingdom of God. I'm not bashing watching TV. I'm not bashing playing video games. I'm not bashing any of that. But let's be honest. Some of us, we know if we were to take an inventory of how we're spending our time, like we could majorly like choose differently about how we spend our time. Time is a commodity, especially when it comes to heaven. And then our talents, this, you know, the idea, the parable is talents, but it's the talent I'm talking about is your abilities. This is like the things, the trade that you've learned, the education that you've received, to take all of that and then to actually use it for the kingdom of God and for his purposes. Every once in a while, somebody will have a skill set and they're like, I want to use this for the kingdom of God. And it's so beautiful. Like my buddy Jared Cook that makes documentaries for Discovery Channel and all of these networks like National Geographic. He says, I have this skill set and I want to use it for the kingdom of God. So he puts together videos like we play here. And he does it for the kingdom. That's using and leveraging your ability or your talent for the kingdom of God. And then your treasure, that's your wealth. And we all have some wealth. But here's the good news is, as we take our wealth and we use more and more of it so that we can further the kingdom of God, God says, I see it. And it all counts in an eternity. That I want you guys to know, when you give to Atmosphere Church, you are helping change lives. Like I had another God story this last week where somebody was prayed for and their life was completely transformed. And we wouldn't be able to do that without your giving. So I said last week, the more you give, the more we go. There's so much that we could be doing for the kingdom of God, but it takes financial resources in order to do it. Thanks to some of your financial resources, we're able to go next month or in the month of June. We're going to Zambia, Lusaka, Zambia. And we're helping build up a school that has been going for 10 years. Now they have almost 500 students that we are educating. It says, take a man fishing, he'll eat for a day. Teach a man to fish and he'll eat for a lifetime. We're teaching men and women to fish. We're educating them. We're helping break the cycle of poverty. And you are helping us make a difference all the way in Lusaka, Zambia when you give. Your gift matters. And you're making an eternal difference. And one day we're going to get to heaven. And just like the scripture says at the end, well done, good and faithful servant. That's what's going to happen. So leverage your time, leverage your talent, leverage your treasure for what really matters for all eternity. And here's the last one. And it's take care of the least of these. Take care of the least of these. So leave your tank on full. Invest in the life to come, and take care of the least of these. The call of God is to take the people that are in our circles that are hurting, to take the people in our circles that are just going through a next level mess, and we're supposed to take care of them. And when we take care of them, it's not like God's like, okay, now you're welcome into heaven. No, the call is when you really belong to God, you will have the heart of God. And God's heart is for the marginalized. God's heart is for the orphan and the widow in their distress. So when you start having an extra level of compassion for people that are marginalized and people that are hurting and widows and orphans in their distress, I want you to know that God is giving you that heart. It comes from Him. And that's an indicator that you belong to Him, because if you belong to God, you're going to share His heart. And you're going to start bleeding for the things that God bleeds for. So take care of the least of these. We did a whole series on this back last fall. And this is how I summarize this last point. If you find a need, fill it. If you find a hurt, heal it. Write that down. If you find a need, fill it. If you find a hurt, heal it. And here's what I know. You live in Westlake Village. You live in Thousand Oaks. Oh, there's no needs around here. There are. We just got to open our eyes and we ask the Holy Spirit, give us your eyes. Let us see the things that we cannot see with our physical eyes. Maybe that person sitting at Starbucks just sipping on a latte was actually just given divorce papers by their spouse that morning. And they're sitting there soaking it in and just there at the table. And what if God puts you at that Starbucks because God knows that you belong to Him and that you are going to be moved with compassion, the same compassion that moved Jesus into action is going to move you into action. So don't let maybe a fancy suit or a nice car fool you to think that people aren't hurting right around us. People are going through things that we have no idea about. We just got to pray that God would make us sensitive in the spirit to those people, to get those Holy Spirit promptings to say, man, I don't know you and you don't know me, but I want to tell you that God loves you. He sees you. He cares about you. And he sent me here today, I believe, to pray for you. More people will receive prayer than you will give credit. There's that little scared person inside of you going, oh, no, don't pray for them. They're going to hate you. More than likely, there will be some people that will hate you. I will tell you that. There's some out there. But 95% of the people, when you step out of yourself and you speak Jesus to them in a loving, compassionate way, they're going to be grateful for you. I mean, think about it. We live in a culture that gets so excited when they get a fortune in their fortune cookie. All right? Let's just call that out, all right? How many of you have like prayed and opened a fortune cookie at the Chinese restaurant going, oh my goodness, look at this? And then there are lotto numbers on the other side. So you're like, all right, this is good. But the bottom line is this. If people can receive from a fortune cookie, how much more special would it be for some stranger to walk up to them and say, hey man, God put you on my heart. I just really feel like I'm supposed to speak to you or pray for you. Are you okay? Wow, that can just be life-changing for somebody. Listen to what Ephesians says a few verses before the other one that I read to you. It says, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Would you agree with me that these are evil days? When they're trying to indoctrinate our four-year-olds and give them gender confusion, you're living in evil days. Hello, somebody. That's the truth. Make the most of your time. I want to end by giving you the scripture from 2 Corinthians because this is the reality check for me, at least. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, it says, all of us must appear in front of Christ's judgment seat. Then all people will receive what they deserve for the good or the evil they have done while living in their bodies. The reason I really feel the Holy Spirit saying, spend some time talking about Matthew 24 and 25, is I can't let you get to heaven and tell God, nobody told me. Nobody told me this is going to be happening. He's going to say, hey, remember? Remember you were at church on April 23rd, 2023, that church in Westlake that was overcrowded, that couldn't fit everybody. You remember you were there? Remember that pastor, what he said to you? You heard. My job as your pastor, as your life coach, if you want to call me that, is to prepare you. And this moment's coming for you. And the first step is to make sure that you are right with God. And the only way you're right with God is having a relationship with his son, Jesus, who died for you. But the second one is if you are already right with God, you have a relationship with Jesus, how are you leveraging your now for eternity? I don't know what the rewards in heaven are going to look like. The Bible describes them as crowns. Maybe they're going to be crowns. I've heard other people describe it like when we get to heaven, we're going to have like houses. Like maybe we're going to have neighborhoods that we're in charge of. I don't know. But I believe every act that we do for the kingdom of God, it's like we're sending lumber in front of our life to build up that house that we're going to live in forever. Remember, Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Then I'm going to come back for you. That's what we talked about last week. So maybe everything we do, maybe we're sending building materials to God. It reminds me of a story I was listening to this week that these two guys, one guy was a taxi driver and the other guy was a pastor. They both died at the same time. And they have this experience where they're standing before God and they're having to give an account for their life. And the taxi guy goes before the pastor and the pastor gets to witness the taxi guy standing before God. And God's saying, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of my kingdom. I prepared a mansion for you. I've got 1,000 acres. We've got wild zebras. We've got all kinds of flowers for you on your property. We even got one of those fancy pools and hot tubs. I mean, this pastor's like listening to this taxi guy get all this stuff. He's like, wow. And he's a taxi driver and I'm a pastor. I can't wait. So it's his turn. He finally gets up there. And as he's standing before the throne of God, God says, well done, good and faithful servant. I have a nice 3-bedroom, 2-bath, nice, you know, track home for you on Heavenly Boulevard. It's great. It's even got room for you to build a pool someday. And the pastor's like, whoa, 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 whoa. God, I'm so grateful. Like, I'm grateful I made it. I'm grateful for this house. But God, I've given my life to serve you and to be there for your people. I don't understand that the taxi guy is getting this mansion and all these acres of property and wild animals all over his property. And God just stops him and says, whoa, 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 son. It's real simple. See, when you preached, people slept. When he drove, people prayed. He gets the mansion. You get the track home. Come on, somebody. That was pretty funny. I had to lighten the mood up. It was really heavy in here. I just had to lighten the atmosphere up, all right? That's, by the way, that's really not how it's going to go down, all right? Okay, I'm just telling you. But I don't know, maybe we have a house. Maybe we have crowns, but I just know because of John and his revelation. I just know when we get to heaven and we have all these scratch and sniff stickers, all these things that we did for God, we're just going to want to lay him at the feet of Jesus, because without him, we deserve nothing. So it all belongs to him. Any crowns we get are going to be given to him because of the crown that he wore for us, the crown of thorns. So in this moment, I want us to really soak in what heaven is going to be like for you when you get there, when your seconds are up. Are you ready to be caught up in the air with him? Just right where you're sitting, just pray, just close your eyes, and Holy Spirit, bring revelation to our minds. Speak to us, God. Maybe it's living with that full tank. God, maybe it's just re-looking at how we're investing our life, our time, talent, and our treasure. Or perhaps, God, it's just like being more mindful to help people in their distress, to be an instrument of heaven to help hurting people. But some of you, I know you're not right with God. Maybe a friend invited you. Maybe you're here because of that tragedy that happened Monday. I don't know, but God does, and he loves you. What makes the gospel is the fact that even though we don't deserve it, Christ died for us anyway, because he loves us that much. We are created in the image of God. We're his imago Dei. And he is here to meet with you in your mess, to love you, to place his spirit in you, to change you, not only to get you right with him, but to get heaven into you in this moment. And if you've never made that decision to surrender your life to Jesus, I want to give you that invitation right now. To say yes to following him, that's as simple as it is. It's the decision that you make, saying, Jesus, I want to follow you. I'm tired of this life. I want your spirit to fill me up. So if you're ready to do that, just right there, just pray this prayer after me. Say, Jesus, today I give you my life. Thank you for absorbing all of my sin on the cross so that I could be made right again in my life. I give you everything in my life. Surrender it all. Fill me with your spirit so that I might live the life that you've called me to live on this earth. And prepare me for that day, God, where I'm going to meet with you and stand before you, God. For I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, I want you to do two things. Number one, tell somebody maybe that you came with, and maybe somebody texts you and been bothering you, say, come to church. Like, text them back and say, I said yes to following Jesus today. And number two, tell us. Text the word follow to 805-334-8700. We want to connect with you. and we want to walk with you through the next steps for you following Jesus in your life. Make sure you have a Bible and all that good stuff. But for those of you that maybe you're already a follower of Jesus, I want to tell you, as we just end our time with worship, I want you to look up, because the Lord is coming back for you. And that day when you meet him in the air, man, I know I want to live every day of my life for that moment, as it says in Matthew 25:23, his master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant." May you be like me, and every day you wake up saying, "God, have fun with me today, for today I'm living for the well done for my eternity." Church, live for the well done. And one day we're going to get to worship in front of God himself. And so I'm going to invite you right now to get up on your feet if you can, if you're able to. And I want us to just imagine we're in heaven. We're worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So worship like you mean it, church. Open up those vocal cords and let's sing it to the throne room of heaven, to a God who loves you, who died for you, who resurrected for you. Let's worship.
Thank you for tuning in today to another great message from Atmosphere Church. If this message has spoken to your heart, would you take a moment and share it with your friends? You can connect with us on Spotify, iTunes, Podcast, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Simply do a search for Atmosphere Church through these various platforms and then click the follow or subscribe button. If you're watching this video on YouTube, you should see it right below this video. It's another great way for us to be able to stay connected with you. If you live in the Southern California area, we would love to invite you to be part of our family. For more information about our church, go to our official webpage at atmosphere.church. Finally, if this service and our other resources bless you, would you consider giving back to Atmosphere Church to support not only these things, but also support the creation of even more resources for you? To make a donation, simply go to our website and click on the tab that says Give. Your gift of any amount is greatly appreciated. Until next time, we pray that you will keep the faith, spread the hope, and live the love.